Welcome to my office. Please, have a seat. Right there. I brought you here today to tell you that, personally, I am very, very disappointed. Because these are the top 10 most disappointing games of 2023!
My sold out flavor is back in stock! G Fuel! Fuel you! Percent off code down below. Buy it. Or I will fuck!
Number 10.
Guaranteed nobody. Name in here is Frank.
We're gonna see which one of these guys survives.
The one on the left.
The one on the left? Yeah. The one on the right. He's got the high ground.
Spears are OP.
Oh shit, here comes I can't keep track of him. This guy, he's still alive. He's still alive. I don't remember the other guy quit. He's like, who do I fight? I don't know who to fight. I'll fight this guy. He's still, hold on to him, chat. Hold
turn
on.
You back.
This is other Joe's
don't turn
guy.
You back.
This is other Joe's guy. Don't lose track of him. He's not doing anything. Oh, there he goes. Ah, he's hitting his own people.
I'm getting too old for this.
So what happens when you provide your fans with a game and a time period that nobody asked for?
Barrow has pre-order cosmetic packs for the first time in the series, a narrow, underrepresented campaign map, Bronze Age Collapse, but with little mention of the Sea People Invaders so far, gimmicky features that make little impact to gameplay like dynamic weather or an arbitrary outpost system, a tech tree that buffs up resource production, battle effectiveness without any real technological or cultural progression, a lack of trade as a major mechanic in an era known for the first major trading network in the Mediterranean, immortal faction leader focused campaign gameplay and narrative design, the same bland, uninteresting battles, especially with problems like unit collisions still present, and $60 for less than half a Bronze Age Total War nobody asked for.
Total War, Pharaoh? And what happens when you overcharge for this lukewarm entry?
But I'm already, I would already rather play any other Total War, honestly, so now I see why some people were upset at $60. No simultaneous turns, that ruins a lot. And then the battles themselves, because of the variety, are kind of boring.
Especially when you're playing with multiple people.
Yeah, the lowest player count in as long as I can remember for the Total War series as a whole.
Pharaoh, the big brand new game, pretty much at launch was trading blows with Medieval 2, which came out like what, 16 years ago, 17 years ago? A long ass time ago anyway, that's basically my point.
But here we are on Monday and they didn't even break 5,000 again, which is, I mean, let alone for a Total War title, is just not good for a new game at all.
And an upset fan base. Worse, compound this fact with one of the worst years for the Total War community, as the developer straight up fought with fans, treated them with disrespect, talked down to them, disregarded what many of them were saying. Hell, just started banning and closing threads that were too negative about the game, and blamed the fans. Said, quote, "The right to discuss is a privilege. It is not an entitlement you earn by playing the game." What the fuck are you talking about?
It was one of those posts that talked around the issue, right? So it was talking around the issue. It wasn't actually engaging with the stuff that people were really interested in. It kind of felt like the teacher getting angry and trying to quiet down the classroom and scolding people. So that did not go down well.
Now, were there assholes in the Total War community? Oh, fuck yeah. There are definitely. Trust me, I know. They are loud too. Never piss off a historical gamer who takes his shit way too serious.
You know, that'd be cool if they would get bloody, but that only happens in DLC if you pay an extra $5. And if the game even has the DLC blood pack, which I don't think Pharaoh has the DLC blood pack yet.
No.
Stupid.
You as the company, you have to rise above it. Their mishandling of the situation even caused them to come out with an apology later on. This downward spiral was made worse with them releasing Pharaoh. And while it wasn't a terrible game in and of itself, it just wasn't it. A side game that suddenly was being sold for full price at a fraction of what normal Total War game scopes would be and encompass. And combined with overcharging for Total War Warhammer 3 DLC with the Shadows of Change, it forced them to actually change direction.
To me, the statement was made tactically ahead of the Christmas and New Year, so people are in a bit more of a positive mood generally, to make some vague 2024 promises veiled in front of some hefty negative news.
Make some hard realizations and try to reverse course. The CEO made a statement. Reduce the price of Pharaoh to where it should have been at 40 instead of 60, and made a number of other promises and concessions. I do have hope that Creative Assembly will turn it around. They are still my favorite strategy game developer, and I want to believe in them. But they definitely need to focus in on their next project intently. Pharaoh was a 6 out of 10 at best, if I'm being generous. And that's just not good enough for this legendary developer.
The fact is, a good game, regardless of Total War or Bronze Age, should be worth hundreds, if not ideally, thousands of hours. Standing on its own merits to me, Pharaoh is at most a 5 out of 10. Everything just feels like half of what it should be. Great mechanics that are not engaging enough, character-driven factions that have no replayability, a stunning campaign map that's only half of the Bronze Age world, and slower-paced battles that have half the balance or AI intelligence that they should have. All of this is simply a missed opportunity.
Number 9.
Got it?
There's a sniper!
I got it!
Grab the thermite! Sniper down, let's go!
Grab this thermite over here! Grab those thermites. And follow me.
Yep, there are two thermites here. Grab them.
Alright, it's been lit. The beacon has been lit!
Alright, now what?
Payday 3! How? How does a formula so simple get botched at release this bad? Did you not develop and learn from Payday 1? From Payday 2? Alex, OJ, and I played Payday 3 this year, and it being my first Payday, I really enjoyed the concept and the experience.
In your ass, Joe. No, if I knew what I was doing, this is my first time playing. I thought it was fun. I thought it was hilarious. I thought it was great. I feel like a tank, but then there's just so many cops and then just shooting, and it's amazing. It's chaotic. It's fun.
I see why this was a hit for many and how it had become the definitive heist first-person shooter on the market with legions of fans and those instantly recognizable masks. And don't get me wrong, I think Payday 3 is fun, I love its gunplay, and our early build seemed functional enough. I had no idea, though, that all the dysfunction lurking at full release, mostly broken matchmaking, always online bullshit with no offline mode options, bugs, performance issues, and server-side crap.
Finally here, and it's functional at least 20% of the time. A new record for modern game release. A real video game. Matchmaking error, baby! Woo! As many of you may know, Payday 3 had a bit of a disastrous launch.
This game had a horrifyingly bad launch that you thought, okay, it will get better and they'll right the ship. Well, it got worse. Several updates later, and it still wasn't in the best shape.
There is no offline gameplay of any kind. Meaning, if you want to even play solo, you need an internet connection. Born just in time to require matchmaking to play completely alone! This decision to have Payday 3 be online only in a spat of cosmic justice was immediately punished when the game launched. So many people were trying to play that the servers could not handle it. Playing with friends? Down. Playing with randoms? Down. By yourself? Down. Doesn't matter, they all use the same servers and the system is down.
No real improvements to your partner's AI, if you're playing solo, just stupid AI, no lobby browser, a lack of tools to try to coordinate with strangers. The best way to play this game was obviously if you had four copies and you play with your known friends, which is how we played, and it definitely helps. It masks some of the game's issues, but pre-planning gone.
And you have to be very careful.
You're here.
Right here, you can use the wall as cover.
When you drop off the bags,
but
and we all want to make another sweep through here and then just jump in through.
And I screenshotted that.
Okay, that's real good stuff. Real good stuff.
Everyone clear with the plan?
I'm ready. Yeah, right. I'm good.
All right.
No lobbies where you can stay with people that you meet online for future matches. You just get dropped afterwards. Infamy progression could be incredibly grindy and frustrating, forcing you to play certain annoying challenges rather than how you want to play. Flaws in the UI, and basically Payday 3 needed more time to cook. I hope it has improved since then, as likely it would have been a 5 out of 10 at release, at best.
No chat, voice or text, nothing. You literally can't plan in the planning phase of the game. Wanna play loud? Your other teammates wanna play stealth and you're sitting there with no silenced pistol and your fingers up your ass for 30 minutes. You can't ask what people are planning on doing before the game starts because in the planning phase, there is no way to plan.
Number 8.
I have not lost. I have not lost his points. His points are fine. Fucking bullshit. Fucking hate this game. This is torture. This is just torture.
Hey everyone, welcome to another rapid fire review, this time for Lords of the Fallen.
Lords of the Fallen. Where Lies of P succeeded, Lords of the Fallen failed. There are some great elements to the game for sure. I personally think it looks awesome. Alex loves the challenges that these games provide and told me how much he wanted to love this game. And I want to make sure I give it the props for what it does well. But there's definitely problems.
And I really tried to give it a chance, didn't I? I gave it a fair shot. I gave it 3 fair shots. Parry should not make you take wither damage. That's stupid. I heard about this. I don't really parry in these kinds of games. This is such a dumb thing.
Skatey feeling combat disconnects with your character, and perhaps worst of all, some of the crappiest targeting in the genre.
My starting weapon for my first playthrough moved me about 12 feet per normal attack, and the enemies take 3 to 4 hits per attack, so I felt like I was doing strafing runs. Targeting in Lords of Fallen is perhaps the worst in any modern Souls-like. Maybe the worst in any modern game. There's no way that paid and competent playtesters ran through this game and tested the targeting and said, yep, this is acceptable.
A lot of it feeling unfair, unearned, not much difference between your weapons. Similar movesets without the excitement outside of boss encounters.
From the midpoint on, I had seen all of the enemy types. The bosses range quite a bit in quality. Unfortunately, I had a few with bugged AI. They got stuck in their own arena or just spun in circles instead of fighting. Some bosses were good, and some presented almost no challenge. And for me, adding a 0 to the total boss hit points in New Game Plus doesn't make the boss fights better. It just makes them take longer. And that's not the same thing.
Similar movesets without excitement outside of the boss weapons. Lots of customization, but a less well-implemented rune system that didn't have much effect overall. The inconsistent boss fights, with there not being that many memorable ones, with the exception of the final boss, because it was so bad.
And only because it's so bad. The final fight is a monologuing giant idiot, and he has a few dozen naked cavemen standing about, and they'll start throwing homing fireballs at you. There's no challenge to it, it takes too long, and when it was over, I couldn't believe that that was the end of the game.
Difficulty here came with fighting the UI, the movement, the targeting system, and getting gotcha'd. rather than actual gameplay difficulty that these Dark Souls games feature so well. A lack of finesse essentially killed this one. The developer seemed very interested, though, in making the game even better, so this one may have improved already by now, despite being disappointing at release. Alex gave the game a 4 out of 10. Disappointing.
Which at the Angry Joe Show is slightly below average game score. It's not a failing score, it's just not up to par. There's definitely fun to be had, there's plenty of content for its price, but in the state I played it in, it just isn't up there with the other successful recent Souls-likes. If you played Lords of the Fallen, let me know how much I needed to get good in the comments, or if maybe you were disappointed too.
Number 7.
You're trying to charge half the price of a fucking game, an entire game, so that I can customize one goblin, one black orc, and one troll? Are you out of your mind? What is this, Madden? Is this worse than Madden? I didn't expect this. I come over here. It's Blood Bowl 3 release day. I'm fucking happy. I'm ready to go. Let's play some. Let's make a league. Let's enjoy our time. And I came and I see 1,000 warp stones. I see fucking buy customization. No. Blood Bowl 3. Yeah, Games Workshop made the best games list twice, but they also hit the most disappointing, colossal screw-ups of last year. And then they all do the same generic animation that they do when they do a touchdown. There's one touchdown animation, and everybody on the field does the one touchdown animation. Blood Bowl, which is one of my favorite tabletop games of all time. A brutal version of American football within the Warhammer universe. It's awesome.
Touchdown, motherfuckers.
Don't touch me. That's it. Don't touch everybody. Sorry. Touchdown.
What is wrong with her model? Yeah, she's not even an elf. One cheerleader who is moving in the most awkward way, literally broke herself in half, collapsed. Or that was my cheerleader, because apparently I gotta pay for additional cheerleaders.
And it even had a great first and even better second game. So this new iteration, 3, we were promised next-gen updated rule set and many improvements over what was already a highly refined formula just a game ago. But when it came out, we all realized the incredibly buggy mess, unfinished game, riddled with insulting microtransactions.
You're gonna charge me digital dice for $3. Digital dice and logos for $3. Are you fucking out of your mind? These dice won't improve your luck, but they might impress your opponent.
Is this fucking blue? You wanna do a blue? Blue, brutal blue cheerleader? You wanna do cheerleader? You wanna sell me a cheerleader? You wanna sell me a cheerleader, brutal blue? Brutal blue cheerleaders. You gotta pay. You want a blue cheerleader? You gotta pay. Warp stones? Really? Fuck off!
You fucking are selling all this customization with paid fucking currency, and there's no, like, non-paid currency option. It's just paid currency. 95. 95? What is that? Is that fucking dollars? You want a fucking dollar for every goddamn piece of customization? You want a fucking dollar. You're joking me.
One of the worst sequels I have ever played. Completely saddled with awful, awful brain dead AI. And it somehow looks just as bad or worse than the last game.
You got it.
That's a touchdown. I'm so excited.
With the worst touchdown animation I have ever seen. Oh. The celebration is after.
A complete visual mess, hard to read interface elements, and boring menu screens. Basic features gone. You had to create one team for offline and another team for online. Why? recycled lines from the last game, from the commenters, and there just being no atmosphere upgrades like we thought that there would be, you know, to justify a sequel. It was incredibly half-assed.
As for Blood Bowl 3, though, I struggle to come up with a reason it needs to exist, other than that someone has bills to pay, I guess. There's less reason to recommend it over its predecessor than an especially weak year of Madden or NBA 2K. It's a sloppy, muddy, buggy rehash of a better game.
How could they screw up something this bad when the template was right there from the last one? I wanted to play this in a league on my Twitch channel with people from our chat. That would have been so goddamn fun to run alongside the NFL season. But no, they done fucked it up.
What is 132 times 6? So you thought that you could make 792 new ways to monetize the game? Fucking genius! This is fucking genius! They'll love us!
No, this is not how you treat your players. And no, this is just greedy as fuck. Individual pieces, 6 individual pieces across 11 different players. No non-paid option, just all paid option. You want me to spend as much as I spent on the goddamn tabletop game?
Lack of polish, squeezing the user base for money, making it like a live service game that doesn't warrant it, absolutely cursed this piece of junk. Yeah, they quickly apologized and tried to right the ship, but by then the damage had been done. What we got was basically Blood Bowl 2, only much, much worse, and lacking a lot of shit that one had done better. It felt like a cash-in. Following right in Madden footsteps, I'm hoping that maybe it's had a miraculous turnaround, but I doubt it.
To see this, to like have that pop up on the screen is my first experience with your game, whether your game is good or bad, you've already fucked it up. You've already fucked up your first impression with me.
Just piss me off. I would have given this a 2 out of 10 at release. It's a bad game.
No, you realize these dice. It's not even physical dice. I can buy a cheaper dice. Physical dice aren't even $3. You're going to charge me digital dice for $3.
Number 6.
What the hell happens when evil finally arrives and confronts the Traveler?
Systems are linked. With 80% of defenses now operational, I'm full of fury, she's got an army, and you got magic green strings. Let's crush this callous guy. Welcome to Neo Muna.
Destiny 2 Lightbringer. Why is this above a bad game? Well, because people expected more, and it's from a well-known AAA developer.
Now that a bit of time has passed, it's safe to say that the Lightfall expansion is quite easily the most embarrassing release this game has ever had the gall to charge money for.
Destiny 2 Lamebringer was the expansion that broke the camel's back in the Destiny community.
Remember this chick from the last expansion? We technically killed her, but then her ghost got away. Uh-oh. So you're probably wondering where she's at. Wrong. Don't even think about it, and we will not be addressing that.
While it might not have been the worst DLC ever, it certainly was among the most pointless.
The Nimbus's one-liners being fired off like it's an open mic at a comedy club are feeling as misplaced as my faith in Bungie to tell a coherent story post-Witch Queen.
In a game where PvP has just basically degraded over time, builds have been simplified over the years and not really enhanced like I assumed. More pointless, grindy missions await you. Yet the biggest failure for Destiny 2 continues to be Destiny's story and lore.
We were created for this moment, to deal with this conflict.
The more they showed, the more confusing and weird it looked, simultaneously advertising this as if it was going to be a huge event in the Destiny universe that's going to fundamentally change everything and answer aching questions, but also promising a goofier, campy 80s tone and setting.
YouTube channels have to do all the heavy lifting there.
This was the moment. This was it. And nothing is explained at all. In a moment where Bungie needed to start answering questions that they had been posing to us for a very long time, they are tight-lipped, narratively speaking. Nothing is answered. There are a lot of things that fall into this category. What stands out like a sore thumb amongst all the others is the veil. I am the lore guy in this community, with, of course, exceptions like Mylan and Evaze, who also do fantastic stuff, but point being, I am the quote-unquote lore daddy, and I can't tell you what the veil is, because I don't know. They don't explain it in the story.
And it's not like it doesn't have immense potential. It still has that all these years later. But it's how Bungie has handled the story bits. It's fucking sad, man.
It's like none of the story or imagery can speak for itself, because often it can't speak for itself. You're simply not given the information to properly engage with what is happening. You have to verbally state this as a new magnitude of threat we've never faced before, despite you spending the majority of the campaign killing hordes of the same enemy faction that have been around since 2014.
Everybody remembers the classic line from the beginning.
Centuries ago, I could tell you of the power of the darkness. There are many tales. Lately, those tales have stopped. I could tell you.
But I won't.
Son of a bitch! You done fucked it up!
Who are you?
Why have you been watching us?
I don't even have time to explain why I don't have time to explain.
Son of a bitch! You done fucked it up! I don't have time to explain that I don't have time to explain. That shit is still happening these days.
The big question has been, what does it want with the Traveler? What will happen when it finds it? And in Lightfall, it does find it.
This is single-handedly the most important lore cutscene in all of Destiny 2. And it isn't even included in the Lightfall expansion.
Just check out the numerous upset videos that came out during Lightbringer from content creators. I hate everything. Bricky, Skillup, Jez, lore channels. Like, I am Bife. It's suffice to say, the narrative team fumbled the ball yet again.
Lightfall should feel like you have stepped into the middle of an active war.
But it simply doesn't.
So much cope going on here in that community. Nothing happened at all. Adding annoying new characters. Dumb lore that seems out of place in the universe. Adding frustratingly little to the story. While Strand was a good addition and fun to play with, most of the players were frustrated by the lack of payoff. Especially with how big Bungie built this up. A bait and switch to those still playing the game. Sure, people saying, well, now it's good. I don't care. I am sure they'll resurrect fucking Cade again to get people interested in this game down along the line. It's getting desperate.
The final shape. It's going to be one wild continuous ride.
Yes.
Lame. A 4 out of 10 at best at release.
So I'm dressed for the occasion. I don't know about you.
Joe, you're gonna see once we get out there, boy.
Bring
you wanna
it.
Go?
Number 5.
Mortal Kombat 1 on the Switch is a straight-up port, running directly off of the Switch hardware. And yes, that is as bad of an idea as it sounds. The expressive facial animations of the current-gen versions are highly compromised, to say the least. Clothing, and sometimes even skin, constantly stretches and clips through body parts, and every so often, you can see straight through them. Those absolutely gorgeous stages that I praised in my other review looked like they had a heavy Gaussian blur filter applied to them in Photoshop and briefly made me think that I needed glasses.
Mortal Kombat 1, the Switch version.
There's a lot of slowdown that affected my timing and led to dropped combos, similar to how it would feel if I was playing online with bad netcode, only this was playing locally against the CPU. But it is something that I felt to a certain degree in pretty much every match that I played.
And yes, the main version too.
But the majority of perspective was like, people just lost interest because there was no content. And people didn't like the microtransaction stuff, and people didn't like how buggy the game was, and people didn't like that the online takes forever to find matches, which is still easily one of the worst parts of the game, that I go online and it's hard to actually play this game.
And while this is here mainly for that pathetic, pathetic Nintendo Switch port that looks so bad it shouldn't even exist,
together aggravating way to play what is a great fighting game on other platforms. It quite simply should not have released in this state, and certainly not at a price that's equal to the superior current gen versions. Along with our video showcasing all the fatalities. And for everything else, keep it here on IGN.
It's actually also here partly for the main game itself. This one fucking hurts me.
Wait a minute. This is a fatality that you can just do, right? You know, if
for
you know
$10.
The code. Serious? Please don't tell me this, Alex. I always try to give NetherRealm the benefit of the doubt. I fucking love their games. And now they're telling me, betrayal! You're going to charge $10 for a fatality? I don't give a fuck if it's Halloween.
Let me just take a moment to say I cannot be any more disappointed with my favorite fighting game franchise. They are turning to the dark side, and there doesn't seem to be anything that I can do about it. I always, always do a Mortal Kombat review. This year, it just felt different. Don't get me wrong, I think the story mode is good as it's ever been.
I'm glad.
Bro, this 5 minutes is better than anything Amazon has ever done. Fucking Rings of Power. And Rings of Power took what, $500 million?
The bet was filled.
So this is guys what we're talking about when we play other fighting games and their story mode is the saddest thing you've ever seen in your entire fucking life. And people are like, what do you expect?
This. I expect it. This is effort. This is time. This is investment. This is... Oh, who's that?
That's 2 out of 3.
That's Liu Kang. Point. This fucking story mode is fucking
badass.
Amazing. Like, honestly...
If I was so hungry, I'd be like, let's continue.
I know. This is amazing. We'll continue tomorrow.
It's like this high-quality movie or Netflix series playing out in its full glory. That team did a wonderful job. I love story mode, and it deserves props. The fighting is solid also. The new cast of characters, while it may not be my favorite, it still makes it case. But the growing cancer of microtransactions and live service tactics. That is what's souring my love for this franchise.
We pay $70 for the game.
Well, you didn't pay 70, did you? What'd you pay?
110!
Oh.
I paid 110 because I was like, I want all the DLC characters. I like the game. I like the company. And now I have to pay $120 to get all the fatalities. This is so fucking depressing to see from NetherRealm.
I just don't think either NetherRealm or WB can help themselves. It's really disheartening how much more effort was put into trying to trap people in live service engagement loops to just keep us playing and spending than was put into making the game as good as it could possibly be, packed with meaningful content that's worth playing.
Compliment all of that shit with like a cameo system that gets figured out pretty quick. A lot of casual fans for NRS games do not like the team stuff. They do not like the fact that you have multiple characters. People don't like that it's a team game. They don't want to have to like learn this stuff. They just want a 1v1 fighting game and they hope the cameos get removed from the game type stuff. From an overall perspective of like the casual perspective, which is the huge majority of people that will remain interested in MK, it feels like they're just burned out.
The amazing crypt that used to be so fun and all those amazing mini games that Ed Boon would dream up, well now it's a gambling machine. Sure, there's the overhead map invasions mode, but it's not the same.
And if people are dedicating their time to playing invasions and shit, that stuff is a slog, man. Like, that stuff, I couldn't even get past 15 minutes. It's brutal.
It's just hard not to miss the fun and the surprises of previous titles with little hidden cool bits.
The reason video's not getting as much viewership, people just not showing as much interest in MK1, why is that happening? Because this is the first time an NRS game has truly faltered with its casual audience in 10 plus years. So a lot of people just drop the game and just don't have any desire to play more of it, or they're just waiting for content later down the line.
And then when they started selling fatalities, that's when I gave up. That's when I said, no, I can't do it. $15 for a Halloween fatality? It's filled with microtransactions, I guarantee you, because they're getting addicted to this shit.
People
and
pay.
I told you about this. I told you about this in the last Mortal Kombat, that this shit is starting to seep out. I've seen NetherRealms, whether it's WB or whether it's NetherRealms, I don't give a fuck because it's affecting us. One of my big asks has always been, they need to add one or two more fatalities to the characters in the game. Maybe we could find them in the crypt and cool little unlocks. Well, they heard us, and they took that as a way to push their live service, season passes, skins, and get another way, yet another way to charge on top of the game's $70 purchase price. Pay me $15, a huge chunk of a full price game for one more fatality? Fuck off!
I think just like the direct comparison of actually having a full feature-rich fighting game is finally there. It no longer is only NetherRealm as the ones to do it. And now Tekken is also doing the same thing seemingly, where like Tekken is a fully ass feature-rich game that's going to bring in a lot of casual audience. And those casuals are going to want to watch tournaments, they're going to want to watch YouTube videos, they're going to want to see people playing the game. Community just thrives as a result of like a good game being a good game, you know?
I was worried this shit would happen with how successful that mobile Mortal Kombat crap has been for WB and NetherRealm. And I was right. I even mentioned in the last MK Angry review, this stuff is starting to creep in and it's killing our love for the franchise. Reverse course now!
Crossplay, MK11 had it in beta, never completed it. Non-existent thus far, we know it's coming, but right now, non-existent 4 months into MK1. There are missing game modes and constant silence from the devs. Back Pro Tour, just really going in on a lot of this stuff.
Kander
here
says, your game is already on the brink of death within 4 months. You need a miracle to save it. I am absolutely embarrassed of being a Mortal Kombat fan right now.
As it stands, maybe Mortal Kombat is 6 out of 10 and a 2 out of 10 for that shit Nintendo port that should not at all have been released.
My train to Busan got delayed.
And when they separate, you're in the match. On the Switch, they clash, say a quick 2 lines of dialogue.
So far, I've got no signs of Tarkon.
Perhaps Earthrealm has her immune.
And then stare awkwardly at each other for about half a minute, while textures pop in and out all around them. I'm just gonna let this play out so you can get a full sense of how bad it actually is. Loading paints are felt the most in both Invasions mode and online play.
Number 4.
And here we are, 6 years later, with Gen 2 of the PlayStation VR experience. We reviewed previously the PSVR 1 in a hardware review. Some of the novelty of VR has kind of worn off for me.
It has. Same with me, unfortunately.
Horizon, Call of the Mountain on PSVR 2. And fuck the PSVR 2 as well, okay? It's a $600 paperweight that sits in the back of most of our streams.
But the VR thing, like I said, has it really lives or dies by the video games.
Exactly. That's what I was going to talk about next. Unfortunately, yeah. I didn't think there was a strong lineup.
Right.
And I feel like for spending $600 just about, it's just not there right
it's
now.
It's not there. Yeah. And
you can see it in the background throughout most of my 2023 videos. And that's a fucking PSVR 2. And I'm still selling this. If, by the way, if anybody's still interested, because surely I'm not. And while we reviewed the headset and gave it overall positive marks for what Sony is trying to do.
But way better.
Better.
When you compare, right, here's a single case. This alone, we were going to say better, right? A single USB-C connection. Versus
five steps.
Yeah, that's a little number five on here. It says, like, fuck that. That rat's nest was so fucking annoying. When you actually look from headset to headset, you're actually quite blown away by the improvements that Sony has made.
The issue continues to be the games. The games, Lebowski. Only, what, 10 exclusives maybe in total? And bunch of those are older games, like exclusives to Sony, like Gran Turismo and Resident Evil, basically.
Cars are closed. You got the fucking interiors. You got the sound. It is great.
Resident Evil.
That's right. Resident.
It just feels like you're there. I fucking love this one. This one was a great one.
No stupid restrictions. You move yourself around.
And it's killer app that was being pushed. Call of the Mountain Horizon, it's one of the most disappointing bait and switch games I played.
Oh, yes, it's climb, called Call of the Mountain.
Climb of the Mountain.
It's Climb of the Mountain is what it is. They bait, in my our opinion, it is, you know, the climb game that released fucking, I don't know, 8 years ago,
literally,
6 years ago.
It is
a reskin version of the climb. So it's the climb. Horizon.
Yeah, 90% of the time you're climbing, you get bored of fucking climbing.
Call of the Mountain, it sounds like Forbidden West. I didn't know that the entire time you're staring at a mountain super close up to your face and you're climbing.
You are face first in a mountain's edge. This is what you see the whole game. It's like, it's shit. And then a few sections of doing some cool side combat against enemies and bosses in the Horizon universe, but not nearly as much. Combine that with some really fucking annoying characters, and you've got yourself a nauseating hit.
There's not a single interesting character.
No,
in the whole thing.
No, I don't remember any of the characters.
The story was awful. The characters were awful and annoying, and the story, it's just, Call of the Mountain is a colossal disappointment. And, I just didn't like it. And so it really kind of soured a lot of my experience with the new headset. So, didn't expect that. Did not expect uninteresting characters. And the price proposition, no. 4 out of 10.
Yeah, it's not worth the view.
Worse, I bought this shit twice. Forgetting that the damn thing came with Call of the Mountain bundled in, and I bought Call of Mountain afterwards. You gotta get a refund. So I inflated those already pathetically low sales stats that Sony saw from this. I gave them one extra sale. Suffice to say, I don't think there will be a PSVR 3. I would be fucking shocked. I think that this is a dead device that will slowly get a drip feed of support in 2024 and be effectively dead by 2025. I think after this, I might be officially done with VR until they can go full wireless with some full graphics and, I don't know, super affordable, maybe something else. But it's all about the games, and so far, they have just not been all that great. It's just not there yet. Boring, uninspired tech demos of games that fade away shortly after all the launch hype leaves you with a pretty impressive paperweight. Till your little brothers or cousins fucking eventually borrow it every bit here and there. But other than that, serves as a massive disappointment.
We're talking like 6 hours of just climbing, and it was pretty annoying.
I'm tired of fucking climbing. let me do something else besides climbing. No.
Right.
Number 3.
What if BioShock was more Russian than squatting in track pants? Atomic Heart. A game mired in controversy for being extremely Russian, all of which was overshadowed by a trailer with a pair of extremely salacious robots. Because the internet is just too horny on main to actually care about politics. Which is too bad, because maybe that would have stopped more people from paying full price for a game that feels like you put prey in the microwave for way too long.
Atomic Heart! A game that showed a ton of potential, and its trailers are really, really interesting. Atomic Heart was that one that I was waiting for in development for a long time. It kind of seemed like a Soviet BioShock with an intriguing alternate history and this mysterious look to it.
All of which would honestly have been fine if they had done a better job ripping it off, instead of feeling like you're playing the RC Cola version of Columbia.
It's like a communist utopia powered by advanced robots? And while the best part is clearly the well-designed environments, the gunplay, the looks of it.
Saving data.
Okay.
Stop it. Get some help.
But that soon gives way to repetitive gameplay, lame puzzles, and some of the worst dialogue from a main character in a long time.
According to biometric readings, this is Patrol.
It is? Crispy critters. Shit. It really is Petrov.
Charles, I'm in the hot shop. Am I gonna turn into a crispy critter if I stay in here too long?
Freaking critters. This place just keeps getting more and more fucked up.
It's not important at all, Stud. You'll have to warm her up, but you can ignore her. She's a dumb tree. Nothing like me.
Crispy critters.
Dude just makes the game so much more painful to endure.
As you step into the shoes of an aggressively generic dutagonist with a sarcastic dialogue dial turned up to 11.
There are robots beneath us.
Really? I thought they were ladybugs.
Who spends all of his time angrily yelling at his robot hand in a dynamic that didn't get any better since Forspoken, and screaming about whatever the f*** crispy critters are.
Awful writing. Weak storyline where not much happens. Just weak melee combat, a bad UI, a world map with way too many fetch quests that I just couldn't be bothered.
Explore endless miles of state-of-the-art office corridor in Atomic Heart's exceeding linear level design, where you're always looking for the next key to open the next nonsensical factory floor.
A 5 out of 10 average game at best that I had way higher hopes for.
Put 3 items on this pedestal that represent the 3 main values of a Soviet citizen: art, labor, and life.
Crispy critters. Now I gotta deal with another crazy ass lock. Fuck, I'm a magnet for annoying bullshit.
Number 2.
Blood for the blood god. I don't need me.
No!
Holy shit. Well,
we got to play for a total of 3 minutes together.
Alex and I are still playing.
What? What did you say?
Nothing.
What is that?
This is
what? Me. What are you doing?
This is dark. Oh no!
You fools!
This game sucks. Give my money back.
Do you not have phones? Just play Diablo on your phone while it's down, idiot. Do you not have phones?
Diablo 4's straight fall from grace started a long time ago with the company Blizzard itself changing into a shell of what it used to be.
I must have been high on crack, methamphetamines, and PCP the day I bought D4, because some part of me felt like I would get to experience the same thrill and excitement I felt from the first two games. I completely forgot that Activision Blizzard these days only pumps out soulless factory line garbage.
Games like Diablo Immortal, mobile shit like that, seem to be the priority now for the company, and its AAA titles have paid the price.
designed more to exploit the player than to give them enjoyment worth $70. Every rotten tactic you can think of was used to artificially increase player retention, and these tactics don't work on me because the best tactic is to just make a fun video game. While franchises like Zelda, Pikmin, Street Fighter, and Dead Space can take 5+ years to release a new game, they make it worth it. They make it for the fans. Blizzard does not.
Diablo 4's launch was, as I thought, plagued by issues.
75 minutes. Can I see if my character's deleted or not?
110 minutes.
Nice.
Book that. I'm out.
Alright, well.
Bugs, a lack of innovations, and this focus on making it a grind for everyone to just sell microtransactions.
Well, thank God we built you. What a blessing for the community.
Do you understand that it is actually statistically harder for a team to be this consistently bad than it is for them to occasionally accidentally be good?
The probability is staggering.
Do you have any idea how low our expectations are?
You are a factory of sadness!
I was worried I was right. Blizzard's continuous wrong-headed decision-making has compromised one of the biggest releases of the year for them. It was so hard for me to get excited about this game. Its uninspired art style, its empty world without unique bits.
Fast forward, we meet the worst character in Diablo, Leah. I mean, Norrell. You're just some lackey to this child doing everything for her. She knows Harry Potter spells. She can abracadabra any demon in her way. Why does she need us? Oh, right, to kill her mom.
It's combat and gameplay that's now arguably being done better in free-to-play rival titles.
Classes are not fun to play. They are balanced to a fault, and each class only has 1 to 2 viable builds. Lazy, unfinished. There's not enough space in the game for the shit you pick up. I don't care why you can't add more bag space. I don't care why you can't add more tabs. It's literally not my problem. It's lazy, it's unfinished, fix it.
It's simply not very fun to play for extended periods of time or to get through the end game with multiple world levels. That endgame stuff, it's garbage, it's borked, it's boring. Endgame builds are boring.
Killed a couple of extremely easy world bosses with random people I'll never see again. Went to another nightmare dungeon and stopped in my tracks and said out loud, I think I got it. I think I'm done. I think I understand what the next 200 hours are gonna be of the game, and I'm getting virtually the same legendaries with the same powers with maybe a percentage more damage, killing mostly the same enemies over and over again, especially in Helltides, fighting the same very limited amount of bosses again and again, doing what feels like the same amount of damage the entire game, with only 5 abilities, and if you're a necromancer, 2 of those are to summon, and if you're a barbarian, almost 4 of those are probably just to shout. I'll continue to ride my janky ass horse, which has a mind of its own and stops and starts whenever it wants to, while very slowly leveling up to get a paragon point that makes me 0.001% more powerful on my way to level 100. I think I'm done.
The shit that's supposed to be exciting isn't. Mega fans might still be lying to themselves and downvote me, I don't care. But Diablo 4 as a live service has lost its way and lost its soul. I didn't even want to finish this thing.
However, if you scroll to the seasonal page, it will highlight the Activate Premium Pass option. So if you hit A by accident, oops.
Let's see if it counted. No!
What?
No! Like, if that's a one-click activation, fuck you, dude.
Okay, be right back.
Fuck you!
They ask you how you are, and you just have to say that you're fine when you're not really fine, but you just can't get into it.
Sure, a single playthrough, it's all right enough. And sometimes fun, you know, but it really fails. And nearly every other legendary aspect that Diablos are supposed to be good at.
Which is why plenty of people are calling for the game to have some kind of offline mode if Blizzard can't get their servers together on their end. Plenty of complaints surrounding how all of the nerfs in the Season 1 patch didn't make the game more challenging and more fun. It just made it more boring, more of a chore, just more tedious and insufferable.
Crappy loot, copy and paste dungeons and bosses, crap balancing, a shit sense of progression, and clueless developers who keep ruining the game and flawed seasonal subsequent updates instead of, I don't know, making it better, reacting to the community feedback.
They purposely removed your waypoints that you had in the Eternal Realm so that they can then make it an objective for you to go back and collect them again. Are you fucking kidding me? And by the way, do remember their original plan was to have you to collect all of the altars of Lilith again? This was their original plan? This is what they had planned?
Don't you think that having a good system will more likely retain players than artificially prolonging the game?
What you say is heresy.
You think you can just make a fun video game and people will play it for no other reason than that? That is not what the data says. That is nonsense.
They're a shell of them from herself. It's not Blizzard. It's Sleet. Okay? I think all of the negative aspects of the game in this one will continue to be added in future sequels and blown up even more. Blizzard just isn't capable of creating the game that players want anymore. 5 out of 10, at best. And that's because there's still some talented people on the team. And of course the legendary characters and story creep through every once in a while. But other than that, disappointing.
The state of Diablo 4. So season 3 comes out, and I would say that season 3 has had the worst reception of any season. Because at least in season 1, people were hoping that it would get better. Now it's in season 3, and people aren't so sure anymore.
I mean, look at the Reddit. So far, at level 52, this feels worse than season 1. Jesus.
Number 1.
He's the top dog.
Him?
It's 227 murders. Men, women, and children.
Hey.
So, Meat, what are you in for?
You see, I took a sip from another man's drink. Yeah, that's right. They call me Drink Stealing Joe. I got sip and drink. I sip and drink right now, I don't care, I sip it real good, you see?
What drinks?
I sip it anyway, and it's drink, it ain't even mine! I drink and drink, it's not even mine, and I drink it!
That's unsanitary, there could be like spit in there? Gross.
Don't it's sip drinking, drink sipper! That's what they call me! Drink Stealing Joe!
Oh, Warden!
I'll sip your drink!
He's got the crazy.
I sip and drink right now!
You're supposed to protect me.
Don't make eye contact. Don't look at him.
I sip it! I sip it real good now. Give me your drinks, bitch! Starfield. A game so disappointing, I now consider it just a straight bad game.
You like to dance close to the fire, don't you?
What?
Hello? Hello there.
I could have easily put this anywhere on the top 10 worst games list. And that's saying something with just how bad some of those games are that we got this year. And while I ended up giving the game in my angry review a 6 out of 10, is a 6 out of 10. I fully regret that generous score. What? There's so many goddamn restrictions and this and that. What do you mean?
Well, good thing you can fast travel anywhere you want in this game.
No, you can't fast travel while you're encumbered.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah. You are over encumbered. I was wearing Bethesda goggles for sure, just unwilling to admit that my favorite RPG developer could put something like this out.
All of this just works. It's not, I'm not kidding. Go where you want, what, do whatever you want.
Upon reflection, I was actually far too kind to what we were ultimately delivered here.
Where do you think you're going?
Where are you
Thomas!
Going?
This is the worst security ever.
Bro, what are you doing?
Thomas!
I just killed your whole fucking crew, bro. This fucking AI. You gonna tell me this is good?
It's trying to get some distance between you guys.
Come on.
Never gonna catch me.
Sure, I did have fun at times, but after fighting the game to do what I wanted.
Honestly, my dance is better than their dance. Joe, this club is whack. Let's go.
How much did you pay to get in?
Cover charge was $30.
Oof.
She's not even dancing. She's pulling rope. Why are you pulling the rope? Stop pulling rope to you. Stop putting the toys in the cupboard. What kind of dance move is this?
Karate. Karate. Karate.
Not even karate.
Karate.
The boring quests, the boring story, the lack of interesting loot, and making us frustratingly wait days between selling at shops that never had any fucking enough money on hand, it made me want to tear my hair out!
Oh my god, Bethesda, what are you doing? Why are you wasting my time?
It takes longer to sit here than it does to travel to a different planet.
What the fuck?
You too have to wait 24 hours.
Mm-hmm. How many meters?
17.
So I waited 24 hours for him to get $600? Fuck you, Bethesda.
The absolutely unforgivable lackluster space gameplay in a space game.
Test the Starship system. Says hold space to test the pulse engine.
Yeah, do it.
Yeah, it'd be one day otherwise.
Whoa!
Without the hyperdrive.
That's pretty sweet.
Oh, and it's just autopilot once you get it locked.
Yep.
Then you can just chill as you zoom through space. I keep going through asteroid fields, man.
This is awesome, man.
Am I supposed to release?
I think we're getting closer. Doesn't look like we're getting closer to this. Are we there yet?
Not being able to land and take off and fly around in the universe. You know, making it feel immersive and engaging instead of just a huge screen of loading screen, loading screen, loading screen, one right after the other.
We have dreamt of a game where we can truly break the creation engine in every aspect. Once you've all upgraded your PCs, you'll be able to explore thousands of barren planets where a real sense of loneliness will start setting in. I mean, we tried to do something new where you could explore with complete freedom in the galaxy. Can you imagine 16 times the loading screens, though?
Yeah, I wish I could talk about the loading screens, and it's quite an experience, and I know everyone here is very excited to experience it soon.
There are very few redeeming qualities when you put them all together, this hodgepodge of from a developer who made my favorite, the most well-known made immersive open world RPG of all time. But this isn't it.
Dog on the ground.
Without now, the animation.
And now he's behind you.
What?
These suckers are fast.
Fucking shit.
There are over 1,000 planets with maybe... The gameplay loop was fundamentally flawed. Bethesda remade their open world RPG formula, but somehow botched its execution in every category that matters for immersion. And while some of that leads to hilariously unintended consequences like my galactic drink stealing crimes.
I drank somebody's drink on accident because it was on the table and nobody was near it. Really? And now I have to go undercover in the Crimson Fleet and risk my life.
I
just wasn't enough to save this game from being the biggest disappointment of 2023. Side characters I could care less about. The stupid floating around minigame to get your Dragonborn powers.
Doing it, Joe. You're doing it.
It's like every kid's movie ever.
Yeah. Started to believe, Alex.
He's starting to believe.
Shut the fuck up.
You can't do this 17 times in the game and expect me to care.
This part is really bad.
Romantic options that are so half-baked, they shouldn't even be in the game. The expectation that you'll want to play the game over and over and over and over through multiple new game pluses as a main feature in the end game, that is laughable.
Would you be willing to retrieve some additional data for me? I'm sure we can work something out. So, are you on board?
The connective tissue between it all was just not it there. The connective tissue between it all was seriously lacking. I had fun only in making my ship and farting around on my own, which the game hated me doing. I couldn't even really be an effective outlaw or pirate or evil bad guy without the game saying no! Bethesda wants you to play one boring ass way with some of the most lackluster missions and side quests I've ever experienced, and a hilariously bad stealth system.
And he would be on the computer. Ah. I lost it. just picturing it though, you just like looking, you're walking, keeping eye contact. See what you're doing.
I can't really recall anything that stands out about the game that I would want to return to. If I had a chance to re-rate it, I likely would give it a 3 out of 10 right now. Especially in its launch state. I can't. Damn, man. That's the list. Do you agree with my most disappointing game of all time? What's yours? Let me know in the comments below. And honestly, get your butts ready. Because if these were the games on the disappointing list, ho, just you wait for the worst games of 2023. Damn it! I gotta do that fucking list now.